to the bass drum.
To contribute to our broader culture by bringing our different voices and faces and communities together. I often think of the LGBTQ community to be very tribal, and we have many different populations that have their own little segments and little niches that sometimes don't communicate with each other and sometimes do. And so, we're a place that brings them all together, and hopefully we share each other's stories of origin with our families of origin, and that way I think that we provide a much richer culture, and I think that that's something very special about being queer. So I'm very excited and proud to be part of this organization for that reason. And we do have a membership program, and I just want to point you to our website where you can check out all the upcoming events that we have as well. We're at glbthistory.org. And why would you become a member? It's so that we can do events like this one and so that we can build our museum and our archives. We get a lot of amazing collections contributed to us, and if you have collections that you may think of from your own history or your family's history, your chosen family's history, that you think may help to fill a gap that we have in our collections, I can't tell you how valuable that is for historians, for students and academicians, documentarians who come into our archives every week and are looking for stuff that will help to fill their stories that they're trying to tell. And so our reach is way beyond this museum and way beyond the people who come to our archives. They're all the books, they're the master's theses, they're the documentary and films that reach really all across the world. And so, and another reason why I want you to contribute and donate if you can, and if you're already a member, to increase your membership level, is because we are not able to do enough with this space. And I love it. You know, frequently we have sell-out crowds like this, and it's kind of a, you know, it's a bittersweet moment for me because I see it's filled and there's people standing in the back, uncomfortable, a little bit annoyed maybe. And they have trouble hearing, and then it gets hot, and the air conditioner comes on, and then you can't hear. And so we're limited by our space. We're not able to exhibit enough. We had to shrink down our lesbians of the 50s and 60s that we're so proud of so that we could make room for pre-World War I exhibit that came up here recently. And then we had to change out something so that we could put in AIDS, and we had to shrink something else so that we could put in leather. And now the cases are getting smaller and smaller, and so they have less depth, and we're able to tell less rich stories. And, you know, I would love to have a gallery this size that's about two spirits, you know, in our full-fledged museum. So that's really what it's about. And so if you can help us with our Vision 2020 campaign, or at least runs out here in 2020, and we're looking for a larger space to move to at that time, and we're looking for a permanent space that can bring our archives and research and exhibits all together into one space. So that's our vision. There's no world-class, full-fledged museum dedicated to LGBTQ history and culture anywhere in the world. And if we're going to do it anywhere, let's do it here. So please join our campaign. And with that, I want to introduce our good friend, Will Roscoe, who I consider one of our stable of community historians, if I may, who has done so much and contributed so much to capturing our stories and sharing them in San Francisco for many years. He's the author of a couple of books that I can't remember, and maybe he'll tell you. And again, I just want to thank again Bates for co-sponsoring tonight with us, and I'll turn it over to Will. Thank you, Will.
Before we get started, I just want to say that this is a presentation about history. It's also a historical presentation. And you'll see the technology is a slide projector. It is wireless, it is digital, but it's what we used to do. Before there was GLGBT Historical Museum, before there was a GLBT Historical Society, there was something called the San Francisco History Project. And this is folks like Ruth Panini, Al Barry, Eric Garber, Willie Walker, who started in Willie Walker's home and held a discussion group. And as people started to uncover history and how could we present it to people, the slide lecture was born. And famously, Alan Barraby did a slide lecture on passing women that he eventually took all over the country. I came along about 85, 86 with my research, and I decided I would do what these people I admired so much had done, and I made a slide lecture. I went to Alan Barraby, he gave me all kinds of advice. He told me things like, when you travel, take your projector with you, so you know that it's gonna work. So this presentation was first premiered in 1987 at Modern Times. Yay! Yay! And it came in all over the country since then. The book came out, and I haven't given it since then. So this is a version of it that hasn't been given since the early 90s. But I wanted to give a shout out again to the History Society. Terry invited you to support them. I'm telling you to come up for $5, put it in the box, and get one of these. You card-carrying member of this organization gets you in free to events that are happening every week and all the time. So let's get started. If you want to fire up the projector. And I don't know, are we able to dim a little bit?
Yes.
I'll try to get rid of that. Stay for a little bit, just for a bit. Just for a minute. Awesome. Nice. Okay. Now we can kind of all go into a space where you can just let the image fill your eyes up. So if you walk up Castor Street to Market and turn right, half a block down, you'll see the newest addition to the Rainbow Honor Block. The Zuni Tchakana or Two-Spirit Wewa. Today, Wewa is probably the best known American Indian Two-Spirit in history. But 25 years ago, when I wrote a biography of Wewa called The Zuni Man Woman, few had ever heard of this remarkable individual. The term Two-Spirit hadn't been introduced. Anthropologists hardly wrote about Two-Spirit people, and many Native communities denied that such a role ever existed. We've come a long way, and we owe it to the brave warriors who founded Gay American Indians in 1975, Randy Burns and Barbara Kelly. Organizations like Bay Area American Indian Two-Spirits, who are leading the way today in reclaiming the Two-Spirit role in American Indian and First Nations communities. Tonight, I want to tell the story of Wewa and the times that she lived in. But to understand Wewa's life, we need to start with the unique community she came from, the Zuni Indians of New Mexico. The Zuni are a Pueblo Indian tribe who live today and have for as long as 2,000 years in western New Mexico near the Arizona border. Their remote location is one reason they have been able to keep so much of their language, religion, and culture. The Zunis live in a high desert plateau region. It's a land of flat-topped mesas cut by broad valleys. Traditionally, the eastern boundary of Zuni land was marked by the Zuni Mountains, where the continental divide runs along the ridge. The western boundary was 70 miles southwest of the village, where the Zuni River joins the Little Colorado River. This place is called Sacred Lake, and it's where the spirits of the Zuni's ancestors live. The Zunis call them koko, or gods. The koko are portrayed in mask dances. The Hopi word kachina is often used to refer to these dancers throughout the Pueblo region. The Zunis have many ceremonies in which the koko appear. Some come in large groups like these called kokokshi. Their name comes from the word kokshi, which means be good, be obedient, be attractive. These are the Zuni ideals of personal conduct. The kokokshi are considered the oldest and most sacred of the Zuni's gods. Long lines of them come into the village during the summer to dance for rain. The Zunis would say, kokokshi never makes people frightened or angry. He is always happy and gentle, and he dances to make the world green. Ancient narratives describe how the Zuni's ancestors emerged from beneath the earth somewhere to the west and began a long migration to their present home. They built villages along the way and encountered other people and sometimes merged with them. In fact, archaeological findings show that the Zunis are an amalgamation of the prehistoric people of the Southwest, the Anasazi to the north and the Mogollon to the south. While Zuni culture is similar to that of other Pueblo Indians, they speak a language unrelated to any other in North America. The population of the village today is about 6,000. When Francisco Coronado arrived in 1540, the Zunis lived in six separate villages. In 1680, after nearly a century under Spanish rule, the Pueblo Indians throughout the Southwest revolted. The Zunis killed the local soldiers and their priests and fled to the top of nearby Corn Mountain. When they came down from Corn Mountain 10 years later, they resettled into the single village where they live today. The Zunis believe they live at the center of the world, the middle place. The middle represents the ideal of the world in balance. A traditional Zuni tries to live in the middle, in balance with the universe, the community, and oneself. Living in the middle, the Zunis recognize six directions: north, west, south, east, up, and down. They use this directional system to organize their world and their community. Colors, animals, and kachina gods are assigned to each direction. There are six kibas, the societies that all men belong to, responsible for the kachina dances. And they've even bred corn and beans in six colors. In Zuni culture, descent is traced through the mother's line. A child is said to belong to his or her mother's clan. The houses are owned by the women, and husbands live in their wives' homes. If a couple divorces, the man goes back to his mother's house. So in this kind of society, children, whether their mothers are married or not, always have a home and a family. Mm-hmm. While growing corn and hunting was the most important work of men, women stored and prepared food and took care of small gardens near the village. Once the harvest was brought into the storeroom, however, it belonged to the women of the household. Women also made pottery and other ceramics. Having watertight vessels for storing and preparing food made a settled agricultural life possible. In the late 1870s, the Zunis were one of the most isolated native communities in North America. The village had been without a Catholic priest since Mexico gained independence in 1821. They had had little contact with Americans either, but this was about to change. In 1878, two Presbyterian missionaries, the Reverend and Mrs. Ely, arrived and started a small mission school. Then, in September 1879, a pack train consisting of two wagons, drivers, four Americans from Washington, and a group of ladies and gentlemen from nearby Fort Wingate rolled into the village. It was the first official expedition of the government's newly created Bureau of Ethnology. And it had come to collect artifacts from and record the customs of what was believed to be one of the most ancient and unchanged societies of Native North America. The expedition was led by Colonel James Stevenson, and it included two unusual individuals who were among the first American anthropologists. They couldn't have been more opposite. This is Frank Hamilton Cushing. He was 22 years old when he arrived at Zuni. Frail, sensitive, and thoroughly romantic, he had developed a fascination with Indians growing up in rural New York. In 1879, he was a curator at the Smithsonian Institution in Washington when he learned of the expedition and managed to get himself assigned to it. When the expedition left Zuni, after 3 weeks, Cushing stayed behind. Let's get this fired up here. Now, James Stevenson had developed a thorough dislike of Cushing and left him behind without supplies. So the Zuni governor made him an offer. "Little brother, you may be a Washington man, but it seems you are very poor. Now, if you do as we tell you and will only make up your mind to be a Zuni, you shall be rich, for you shall have fathers and mothers, brothers and sisters, and the best food in the world." So Cushing moved in with the governor's family, learned the Zuni language, and was eventually initiated into the Zuni Warrior Society, the Bow Priests. This is how he looked when he returned east 4 years later. The costume is really a publicity stunt. Very little of it is how Zuni men actually dressed. The other notable member of the expedition was James Stevenson's wife, Matilda Cox Stevenson, known to friends as Tilly. Tilly Stevenson was one of the first professional women scientists in America. When James died in 1888, the Bureau of Ethnology hired her to complete his studies. In 1904, she published a 600-page report on the Zunis, one of the most comprehensive ethnographic studies of a single Native American tribe written up till that time. Stevenson was described as a formidable woman. Her friends considered her able, self-reliant, and fearless. But at Zuni, she's remembered for bullying her way into ceremonies, interfering with tribal governance, and paying members of the tribe to reveal religious secrets, even with alcohol. There is an old joke that a Zuni household consists of a mother, father, children, and an anthropologist. But the impact of anthropologists and other Americans who went to Zuni over the course of more than a century is no joke. Their presence and actions were often disruptive and led to sharp divisions within the tribe. The artist Thomas Aikens painted this portrait of Cushing in his Zuni drag. Here's what Stevenson had to say about this picture. "Frank Hamilton Cushing, in his fantastic dress worn while among the Zuni Indians. This man was the biggest fool and charlatan I ever knew. He even put his hair up in curl papers every night. How could a man go weighted down with so much toggery? Now, how the Zunis saw Stevenson is revealing. In her report, she describes an occasion when the Zunis were planting prayer sticks in the fields. These are offerings to the ancestors, and different prayer sticks are offered by men and women. The Zunis give Stevenson male prayer sticks, and they tell her, "Though you are a woman, you have a head and a heart like a man, and you work like a man, and you must therefore make offerings such as men make." Stevenson seems to have made only one real friend in the village, an individual no less intelligent, curious, and self-confident than herself. The Stevenson expedition had borrowed a room at the mission and began collecting pottery and other artifacts. While Zunis lined up to trade their heirlooms for American coins, Mrs. Stevenson began looking for members of the tribe who would answer her questions about their culture and beliefs. She soon met an unusual individual who was working for the missionaries, Wewa. As Stevenson later wrote, Wewa was the strongest character and most intelligent of the Zuni tribe. As she discovered, Wewa had an extensive knowledge of Zuni history, culture, and ceremonial life. But there was something different about Wewa. According to Stevenson, she was perhaps the tallest person in Zuni, certainly the strongest, both mentally and physically. Many years passed, however, before Stevenson realized the truth. Wewa was a man. That is, a male person who dressed as a woman, engaged in both male and female occupations, and combined male and female traits with traits that were neither male nor female. The Zuni word for such a person is tlamana. Cushing also knew Wewa and claimed she was a hermaphrodite. Stevenson, for her part, gave no credence to Cushing. As she wrote in her report, she continued to regard Wewa as a woman. However, Wewa's sex was no secret. Another white visitor from the same period wrote, "It was the comments of her own friends, Zunis, that first made me wise to the situation as to her sex." Even when Stevenson did find out, she wrote, "As the writer could never think of her faithful and devoted friend in any other light, she will continue to use the feminine gender when referring to Wewa." And indeed, when writing about Wewa by name, Stevenson uses she and her. But other times, when she's writing about Wewa but not by name, she uses he and him. We don't know which pronouns Wewa would have preferred, and the Zuni language doesn't have a pronoun for she or him. As Stevenson wrote, explaining her confusion, "One is led into this error by the Indians, who, when referring to men dressed as women, say, 'She is a man,' which is certainly misleading to one not familiar with Indian thought." That Stevenson respected and admired Wewa comes across throughout her report. She possessed an indomitable will and an insatiable thirst for knowledge. Owing to her bright mind and excellent memory, she was called upon when a long prayer had to be repeated or a grace was to be offered over a feast. While she most willingly took the harder work from others of the family, she would not permit idleness. All had to labor or receive an upbraiding from Wewa, and nothing was more dreaded than a scolding from her. To her credit, Stevenson wrote more on the subject of two spirits than almost any other anthropologist until the 1980s. She defined tlamana as men who do woman's work and wear woman's dress. Boys were recognized as tlamana largely because they preferred hanging around the house. Some insight into how tlamana understood themselves comes from an account of an American school teacher who was at Zuni in the 1890s. She asked a young tlamana named Kwiwishti why he wore female clothing. "Because," he explained to an interpreter, "he did women's work." "But I often do a man's work," the teacher replied, "and I do not put on a man's clothes to do it." Kwiwishti and the interpreter spoke for several minutes, and then the interpreter explained. "He says that you do not love all the people in the world as much as he does, and that's why he does that." According to Stevenson, women were usually supportive of such a boy. It means that he will remain a member of the household and do almost double the work of a woman, who necessarily ceases at times from her labors at the mill and other duties to bear children. The Schwammerdam role involved complex interweavings of male and female. In a census of the tribe that Cushing made in 1881, he listed Wewa's occupations as farmer, weaver, potter, housekeeper. The first two are male occupations, the second female. And Wewa and other Schwammerdam underwent the same initiation rite all boys received before becoming members of the men's religious societies. Stevenson struggled to balance her Victorian sensibilities with her urge to be objective when she wrote about the sexuality of Schwammerdam. There is a side to the lives of these men which must remain untold. They never marry women, and it is understood that they seldom have any relations with them. In other words, they married men. The next anthropologist to write about the Zuni Schwammerdam was Elsie Clues Parsons. In 1915, she observed three adults and a six-year-old boy. She described two of the adults as masculine. The boy had been identified as a Schwammerdam because he used the speech patterns of a girl. According to Parsons, the Schwammerdam were skilled potters and plasterers. Her informant had known of nine in his lifetime. Parsons provides the only reference to a female counterpart of a male Schwammerdam. She described a woman named Nancy, who was teasingly referred to as the girl man, or Katsotse. Nancy had been initiated into a men's kiva society. And in an important ceremony that I'll talk about later, she wore a kachina mask, usually worn by a male Schwammerdam. In fact, I've been told that in the 1800s there were as many female two-spirits among the Zunis as male, although it's not clear if the term Schwammerdam was used to refer to them. These women did not necessarily dress as men, but they engaged in men's activities and were often among the occasional women initiated into the Kachina society. In the early 1990s, I had a conversation with a Zuni friend and a gay man from Taos, Taos Pueblo, in a disco in Santa Fe. The man from Taos told stories about being bullied as he grew up. So I asked my Zuni friend if that ever happened in Zuni. No, he replied, because we have Koshwamana. He was referring to a Zuni Kachina whose name comes from the word Klamana with the prefix Ko, which means spiritual or God. Koshwamana wears the same mask as the male Kachina called Kokokshi, but Koshwamana's hairstyle is unique, wound in a circle on one side in the style of a woman, and hanging down on the other side in the style of a man. Zuni mythology relates the origin of the god Koshwamana. On their migration, the gods of the Zunis encounter hostile enemy gods, and a war breaks out. The Zunis are farmers, while the enemy gods are hunters. So the story contrasts the creation of life involved in agriculture with the aggression and taking of life involved in hunting. The enemy's leader is called Chakwena Okya. Her name literally means warrior woman. She is a powerful figure that cannot be killed with normal weapons. The two sides are at a stalemate. Then Chakwena Okya captures Koshwamana and two other Zuni gods. According to Stevenson, the enemy gods had a dance in which the prisoner gods appeared in celebration of their capture. Koshwamana was so angry and unmanageable that Chakwena Okya had him dressed in female attire previous to the dance, saying to him, "You will now perhaps be less angry." This transformation amounts to a rite of passage, an initiation in which an old identity dies and a new one is born, symbolized by the new clothing Chakwena Okya provides. Following this episode, the Zunis and the enemy gods end their war and unite as one people. Symbolically, this represents a balancing between hunting and farming, and in turn, a balance between male and female, and between winter, the season of hunting, and summer, the season of growing. These events were dramatized every 4 years in a complex ceremony. The enemy gods entered the village from the south, with Kohlamina, portrayed by an actual Kohlamina, appearing as the first of the captured gods. Kohlamina wears the mask of the Maoka Koshi god, who is a farmer, but also carries a bow and arrows. And while wearing a woman's dress, there is a man's dance kilt draped over the shoulder, and the hairstyle is half female and half male. It's the ability to bring these opposites together that makes Kohlamina extraordinary, and by extension, individual Kohlamina as well. Weiwa was a significant figure in Zuni history. George Wharton James, a popular writer at the time, described Weiwa as one of the most noted and prominent members of the tribe. Robert Bunker, an Indian agent in the 1940s, wrote, "Weiwa, that man of enormous strength who lived a woman's daily life in woman's dress, but remained a power in his Pueblo's greatest councils." Stories about Weiwa are still remembered by Zunis today. She was born about 1849. Both of her parents died when she was a child, and she was adopted by an aunt. Her foster father was a prominent rain priest. Stevenson described them as the richest family in Zuni. She discovered that Weiwa was an accomplished potter. Collecting pottery was one of the goals of the 1879 expedition. The Stevensons shipped more than 2,000 items back to Washington. But Weiwa's pots stood out, and Stevenson commissioned her to make pieces for the National Museum. Today, the museum holds three items that we know were made by Weiwa. One is the bowl in this picture, used to hold sacred cornmeal for ceremonies. We know two others were made by Weiwa because she signed them. And this is remarkable. Hardly any Zunis, or any, if any at all, knew how to write at this time, and Indian artists didn't start signing their works until the 1930s and 40s. So these pieces may be the first instance of a Native artist signing their work. The interior decoration of this bowl is a masterpiece of Zuni design. The abstract forms are feather symbols and are prayers for rain. On the bottom, we can make out simple writing that seems to read 2822, Mama, and then the word male, or maid. Now, Weiwa had seen the Presbyterian missionaries trying to teach the Zunis letters of the alphabet. And she had seen how the Stevensons wrote something about all the items they collected in a book. With this limited knowledge of writing, Weiwa wrote her name with upside down W's that look like M's. And 2822 is probably 1882. And male is probably maid. The second item signed by Weiwa is a decorated water jug. Here, the design depicts a deer in a feather house. The red line to its heart represents its breath or soul. It has the date 1884 on the handle, along with Weiwa's signature. The deeply religious nature of Zuni pottery making is illustrated in Stevenson's account of a time when she and her husband went with Weiwa to gather clay at Corn Mountain. At this site called Mother Rock, she tore off a piece of her Viking as an offering. According to Stevenson, when she drew near to the clay bed, she indicated to Mr. Stevenson that he must remain behind, as men never approached the spot. Proceeding a short distance, Weiwa requested the writer to remain perfectly quiet and not talk, saying, "Should we talk, my pottery would crack in the baking, and unless I pray constantly, the clay will not appear to me." After gathering about 150 pounds in a blanket, which she carried on her back, with the ends of the blanket tied around her forehead, Weiwa descended the steep mesa, apparently unconscious of the weight. At one point, Stevenson decided to introduce soap to the Zunis by teaching Weiwa how to do laundry. What she didn't know was that Weiwa had already been washing clothes for the missionaries. And Stevenson, from a middle-class family in Washington, D.C., had never washed her own clothes before. So when she spilled water all over the floor, Weiwa dryly observed, You do not understand that which you would teach. You do not understand as much as the missionary's wife. She keeps the water in the tub and does not make a river on the floor. According to Stevenson, after this, Waymo went into business washing clothes for local whites. Waymo was also a weaver at a time when the number of Zunis who still practiced the art was dwindling. According to George Wharton James, proud indeed is that collector who can boast of one of her weave among his valued treasures. Now, among the Pueblo Indians in general, men did weaving using large looms to make blankets. But at Zuni, women sometimes wove using a small loom to make belts and sashes. As you can see, Waymo used both kinds of looms. As her adopted mother got older, Waymo took on responsibility for managing the household with her mother's oldest daughter. This was the role of a younger sister. But in other contexts, as we will see, Waymo was referred to as a brother. Stevenson and Cushing became bitter rivals. In 1882, Cushing brought a delegation of Zunis east and received extensive publicity. Stevenson decided she had to keep up. So in late 1885, she brought Waywa to Washington. The 6-foot-tall Zuni Two-Spirit spent 6 months in the Stevensons' home. Waywa learned basic English quickly, and according to Stevenson, came in contact only with the highest conditions of culture, dining and receiving with some of the most distinguished women of the national capital. Another account describes Waywa with wonderful dignity and self-possession, moving among the most enlightened society of the metropolis. During her stay, Waywa bought a red satin parasol and took long walks on her own through the city, finding her way by following the trolley tracks. Matilda Stevenson was part of a network of the wives and daughters of prominent men. They were intelligent and ambitious women in their own right. Stevenson took advantage of her contacts to promote her projects and the Bureau of Ethnology. She introduced Waywa to key national leaders, including the Speaker of the House of Representatives, John Carlisle. According to Stevenson, the Speaker and Mrs. Carlisle were very kind to Waywa, and upon her return to Zuni, she found a great sack of seed, which had been sent by the Speaker. In May, Waywa participated in a charity event, an amateur theatrical put on by Washington Society women at the National Theater. The entertainment consisted of a series of themed dances called tableau, in which the performers hustled about the stage, then suddenly froze into a still portrait of a dramatic moment in literature or history. Waywa appeared, of course, in the Indian dance. According to a newspaper account, the presence of the Zuni priestess Waywa added to the realistic effect of the warlike spectacle. In the audience sat the president, senators, congressmen, and Supreme Court justices. Well, what did Waywa think of all this? According to the Washington Post, she betrayed some surprise at the curious movement of the dance, and said she had not seen anything just like it among her people, but it was very nice notwithstanding. Waywa appeared in the paper several times during her stay, and no one questioned whether she was a woman. Although, as one reporter wrote, folks who have formed poetic ideals of Indian maidens, after the pattern of Pocahontas or Minnehaha, might be disappointed in Waywa on first sight. Her features, and especially her mouth, are rather large, her figure and carriage rather masculine. She speaks a little English, and her manner is very gentle. Still, the reporter refers to Waywa as a priestess, and others called her the Zuni princess, Zuni maiden, or simply girl. During her stay, Waywa helped Stevenson document Zuni culture. She demonstrated weaving here, inside the Smithsonian, then set her loom up on the mall. This series of pictures is one of the earliest uses of photography to document the techniques of Native arts. Waywa ever continued to follow religious practices while in Washington. On the summer solstice, she performed a prayer stick offering in the backyard of the Stephensons' home, timed to occur simultaneously with similar rites being held at Zuni. And making prayer sticks, by the way, was typically done by men. In June, Stephenson wrote to President Grover Cleveland's private secretary, "Dear sir, Wewa, a Zunian Indian priestess who has been spending the winter with me for the purpose of ethnological study, will in a short time leave for her faraway home. She is anxious to meet the president and Mrs. Cleveland and to extend to them a greeting from her people." On the 23rd of June, 1886, the Washington Post reported, "Wewa, the Zuni princess, walked up the broad entrance to the White House and in company with Mrs. Colonel Stephenson was shown into the green room. She was dressed in her aboriginal costume and wore a headdress of feathers. Her conversation with the president was mainly in monosyllables, but Mrs. Stephenson and the president had quite an interesting talk." The trip had a lasting impact on Wewa, and she told many stories when she returned. According to Edmund Wilson, who visited Zuni in the 1940s, he assured his compatriots that the white women were mostly frauds, for he had seen them in the ladies' rooms, taking out their false teeth and the rats from her hair. Washington society, of course, would have been shocked to learn that Wewa was a man. And after Stephenson published the facts 15 late years later in her report, jokes at her expense circulated for many years. Another key incident in Wewa's life involved a famous case of witchcraft. Anthropologist Dennis Tedlock describes the Zuni definition of witchcraft this way. "Some people, never one's own kin, are witches. Men and women who get sick at heart when someone has better fortune than they do, or when someone insults or even merely slights them. A witch will wish and plot the death of a person who makes him feel sick." So the witch uses magic for personal ends instead of the good of the community, to get riches, revenge, or sexual favors. Suspected witches were prosecuted by the Bow priests, the Zuni war leaders, who tried to make the accused confess. This man, known as Zuni Nick, worked for the white trader at Zuni, and he had learned to speak English. As a young man, he rejected Zuni ways and even mocked the priests. In 1882, when a drought and smallpox epidemic aroused fears of witchcraft, suspicion fixed on Nick. One night, the Zuni governor gave him whiskey. They got drunk and claimed to have witch-like powers. The Bow priests arrested him and strung him up in the large plaza. His white friends rescued him and sent for help from Fort Wingate. Soldiers were immediately dispatched to arrest the governor for giving Nick whiskey. But when they arrived at the governor's house, they were met instead by the 6-foot-tall two-spirit, Wewa. Years later, Lena Zuni, who witnessed the events, described what happened. "The soldiers were going to take my sister's husband. His younger brother, although he was a man in woman's dress, got angry. He hit the soldier. When they were going to take his brother, although he pretended to be a woman, he hit them. He was strong. He stood holding the doorpost and would not let them come in." Oops, According to a white version of the same event, "An officer who with the sheriff went to the governor's house to arrest him was bodily thrown out of doors by a woman, or what at the time was supposed to be a woman, which amounted to the same thing. In making his exit, his coattail caught in the door, which being immediately closed, held him in this position until, thinking of the saber, which until now had remained in the scabbard, he valiantly drew it and extricated himself from his unpleasant predicament by severing his coattails from their attachment, becoming again a free man." Well, the soldiers returned in full force, nearly 200 men, armed with guns and field artillery. They arrested the leading bull priest, the governor, and Wewa. Wewa spent a month in jail at Fort Wingate, and when she was released, she had to walk 40 miles back to Zuni in the dead of winter. The The most personal and moving passage in Stevenson's book is her account of Wayward's death. In the fall of 1896, Wayward's house hosted one of the Shawako gods, 10-foot-tall Kachinas who come to the village every fall to bless newly built houses. According to Stevenson, Wayward suffered from heart disease, and the effort of preparing for the ceremony proved too much. Stevenson wrote, "From this time, she was listless and remained alone as much as possible, though she made no complaint of illness. When a week or more had passed and the many guests had departed, the writer dropped in at sunset. Wayward was found crouching on the ledge by the fireplace. Only a few days before, this strong-minded, generous-hearted creature had labored to make ready for the reception of her gods. Now she was preparing to go to her beloved sacred lake. Wayward asked the writer to come close, and in a feeble voice she said in English, 'Mother, I am going to the other world. I will tell the gods of you and Captain Stevenson. I will tell them of Captain Carlyle, the great sea priest, and his wife, whom I love. They are my friends. Tell them goodbye. Tell all my friends in Washington goodbye. Tell President Cleveland, my friend, goodbye. Mother, love all my people. Protect them. They are your children. You are their mother.' She leaned forward with the prayer sticks tightly clasped, and as the setting sun lighted up the western windows, darkness and desolation entered the hearts of the mourners, for Wayward was dead." Now, what happens next is interesting. Blankets were spread upon the floor, and the brothers gently laid the lifeless form upon them. After the body was bathed and rubbed with meal, a pair of white cotton trousers were drawn over the legs, the first male attire she had worn since she had adopted woman's dress. The rest of her dress was female. This simple burial rite reveals the complexity of Wayward's gender identity. 20 years later, Parsons learned an additional detail. She knew that men were buried on the south side of the cemetery, in front of the old mission, and women on the north. So she asked Izumi Elder, on which side would Automata be buried? On the south side, of course. Is this not a man? Wayward's death was considered a great loss, and it led to another witchcraft trial. This old woman was accused of witching Wayward out of jealousy. When the priests tried her, the soldiers came again. They occupied the village for 6 months, and the bow priests were kept in jail for more than a year and a half. This broke their power to control outside influences. We might ask why Wayward wasn't accused of witchcraft. She might have, because of her close relations with white people. She could have revealed religious secrets to them. But if Wayward wasn't accused of witchcraft, it was because she had the trust of the community. The Zunis would say, Wayward had a good heart. Wayward was curious about American culture and cultivated friendships with Stevenson and others, seeing them as potential allies for her people. Acting as a gatekeeper, she sought to mediate their impact on the village. She took a great risk by cooperating with Stevenson, but she saw a value in recording Zuni culture. And she was an innovator. As a crafts expert, Wayward helped develop traditional Zuni arts into a livelihood that many depend on today. Two spirit roles like that of the Zuni Klamana have always been evolving. As Halia Zanajanin, an early member of DAI, once told me, tradition is reinvented in every generation. The stories of two spirits like Wayward, the master Navajo weaver and powerful medicine man Hustin Kla, and the legendary crow Ochish, or finds them and kills them, whom I write about in my book, Changing Ones, reveal that sexual and gender diversity can be the source of unique social and cultural contributions. In the words of a crow elder, we don't waste people the way white society does. Every person has their gift. Eva Kwa, Thank you. Now, we're going to have a transition of equipment from the last millennium into the current one. And the Bates Organization and Roger Kuhn are going to do a presentation about the organization and its work and what's going on today. I'll take a couple questions while this equipment shift happens. I see you. I just want to, I see the equipment shift is happening. Okay. Joey.
Have any Huaywa's weavings ever been identified?
No. Mr. Burns.
Yeah, the governor. A lot of nominated people who might play that role. You know, not
sure.
The state of New Mexico.
No. Yeah, and this is, so the governor was the secular leader in Pueblo villages. It was a office that was instituted under the Spanish. And it was instituted to put a buffer between the religious and traditional leadership, which were priests and war leaders on the one hand, and the Spanish. And then it continued. It was a position appointed by the priests. Up until the time, and where's my friend Lindsay, who knows about the Indian Reorganization Act, tribes were given the opportunity to constitute themselves more or less like a city or a county government and have elected officials. This was divisive because this was not the traditional way. And it's been a long transition for many tribal communities to develop an effective way of governing themselves under this system. I don't know how. That's, yeah.
Was the term Burdash used to describe the two spirits in the Zuni?
Oh, I wish you hadn't brought that up. it's a whole other evening's talk. Scotty's referring to a term that you would say is really kind of has become the anthropological term for these third gender wolves. Burdash. Spelled generally B-E-R-D-A-C-H-E. It has a long and complex history. And it is a European term, but the reason that it got picked up by the anthropologists was that it was actually a frontier term. French had first used it in the 1600s in the trading industry, the trading fur trading context. It passed quickly to French Canadians and to native users who that's all they knew. It was a French intertribal term for third gender roles in many different tribes. And it had a long history. So when the anthropologists started to show up on the frontier, they heard it being used there and they started to write it down. And most of them had no idea of its earlier use in Europe. So that's how it came into the anthropological literature. But it's a strange word, and because of its European origins, it was, by the 1990s, widely felt to be just inappropriate. And so the term two-spirit was introduced as the self-chosen and preferred and respectful term for this role traditionally and the identity of LGBTQ native folks today. And I've been perilously close to speaking for my friends, but that is the answer. So, is it ready? Oh, okay. Anything else? Yes?
Sorry if I missed this earlier in the presentation, but can you describe, maybe repeat or clarify your relationship to the Zuni Pueblo and maybe as it's evolved?
I first went there in 1984 to witness the Shalako ceremonies and dances, which at that time was open to outsiders. I don't think so anymore. In 1987, I reached out to the tribe and asked if I could come and present my research to get feedback, to find out how folks would feel about it before I published it. And as a result of that visit, which went very well, I was sponsored by the tribal council. I met Zunis and have had friends there and been back to visit a few times, not a whole lot, not lately, but I'm in touch with folks there and talk every other week, and we do text messages and pictures, Weiwei is a very well-respected figure to this day in the village. And then I hung out with this guy and this one and other folks from GAI starting from 1985. We worked together. GAI sponsored and published the first book of writings by gay and lesbian and queer Native American Indians called Living the Spirit, 1988. And we've been girlfriends ever since. Over to Bay Area American Indian Spirits.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for coming. Welcome. I'd like to start by acknowledging that we're on Ohlone land. I would like to start by thanking and acknowledging that we're on Ohlone land this evening. So my name is Roger Kuhn. I'm an enrolled member of the Porch Band of Creek Indians. I'm the current chair of the Bay Area American Indian Two Spirits. We like to say Bates, so you'll be hearing me say Bates from this point forward. The mission of the Bay Area American Indian Two Spirits is to recover and restore the role of Two-Spirit people. We do this by creating a forum for the cultural, artistic, and spiritual expression of Two-Spirit people. I would like to start by acknowledging Mr. Burns, Randy Burns. Thanks again. It is on GAI shoulders, Gay American Indian shoulders, that we gently stand tonight. Randy, we owe you a debt of gratitude. Thank you so much for your continued work for our community. When I was an undergraduate, I started to study Two-Spirit culture, and in particular, I remember reading Will's book and scouring the internet in its early days and coming across the name Randy Burns. And I thought, my gosh, maybe one day I'll get to meet him. And then I moved to San Francisco years later, and I went to my first Pride Parade with Bates, and there he was. And so it's an honor to see you here again tonight and now to call you my friend. So let's talk about some issues that are currently impacting Two-Spirit communities. These are just some issues. Access to water, land, culture, colonial mentality, urbanization, HIV and AIDS, violence, access to health care, education, love, intimacy, sex, pleasure, exotification, marginalization, homophobia, and racism. These issues impact Two-Spirit people in their communities, in their tribal communities, in their urban communities, in our urban native centers, and in public spaces such as the Castro. We want to talk about Two-Spirit supporting healing the circle. This is an invitation inviting all to witness and participate for visibility with Two-Spirit LGBT, Two-Spirit people, and others. We do this by creating and leading a space for Native people to expand our circle and inviting non-Natives, and expand to Latin America and Native Hawaiian as well. We have several programs in our organization. First and foremost, and hopefully maybe some of you have attended, is our Two-Spirit Powwow. Did anybody attend this year? Thank you so much for coming. We greatly appreciate your support. We open this evening with our lovely group, the Bates Drum. Thank you so much, my sisters, for doing all that you do for our organization. Throughout the year, Bates also offers regalia-making workshops, powwow dance classes, and social gatherings. We do this in order to give a place for Two-Spirit people to come together, to create community, and develop a new sense of family. Over the years, Bates has had collaborations with several Native organizations in the Bay Area, including the Native American AIDS Project, the Native American Health Center, and the Native American Health Center, Culture as Prevention. Recently, this book was released in 2018 by Andrew Joe Levett, called Indian Blood. This book was an operation with the Native American AIDS Project and the Bay Area American Indian Two-Spirits, in which information was gathered about the impact of HIV and AIDS in the Bay Area amongst Two-Spirit people. It's a phenomenal read if you have an opportunity to read it, and if you ever have a chance to go see Dr. Joe Levett speak, I also encourage you to do so as well. So we have just celebrated our 7th annual powwow. Bates holds the distinction of being the first public Two-Spirit powwow in the entire world. When they started the powwow 7 years ago, in 2012, I didn't live in San Francisco. I arrived the spring afterwards, and one of the first people I reached out to was my friend Miko Thomas. And I said, Miko, where should I live in San Francisco? And he shared with me some communities to live in, and then he said, oh, by the way, drop by the community center. So I went by the community center and I met Ruth, who said, hey, come to Pride the next day. And here I stand, 6 years later, as the chair of the board. So thank you so much to Ruth and to Miko for helping me get to where I am at tonight, and for really being the leaders that you have been of our organization over these years. As I mentioned, most recently, Bates celebrated our 7th annual powwow. It happened on February 3rd. It was the culmination of many people who are here in this room this evening, the hard work and the dedication they had to the Bates organization and to our Two-Spirit community. I'd like to share with you now a few photos from our event. So those of you that were there, you might remember Grand Entry. And we also had this lovely image that I was really struck when I saw this image. And there's so much beauty in this image for me about the color and the dance and the motion and the capture. And Ruth, I think this is one of our pictures for the exhibit next year. So I'll announce that really quickly. In conjunction with the GLBT Museum, Bates is going to be working on an exhibition that we hope to have ready next February as we celebrate not only our 8th annual Two-Spirit powwow, but also the 20th anniversary of the Bay Area American Indian Two-Spirits. So this is a picture of our board member, Ruth, with her lovely wife, Diane, and their friend in the middle, whose name I did not know.
Marlene.
Marlene, yes. These were our head dancers this year, Candy Brings Plenty, Jaren Goggles Lar, and John Sneezy. Here are some representations of different individuals. We also, part of the powwow is a competition where we offer funds for dancers, and some people come and participate as well in traditional regalia. Our powwow is a free event and open to the public. The past few years we've been holding it at Fort Mason Center, which we hope to do again this year. And we're hoping and aiming for the first weekend in February of 2018. So if you have a calendar, I invite you to write it down now so that you can come next year as well. 2019, that's right. 2019. It takes me a couple months before I start actually using the right year. Thank you for that. This was our 2018 powwow committee. As I mentioned, several of those members are in the room tonight, and I would like to again express my gratitude for all of you for the hard work that you did. This was our most successful event yet, and we continue to grow more and more over the years. Estimates range anywhere from 5,000 to 6,000 people attending our event this year throughout the day. If you're around this summer, we invite you to join us at the San Francisco Pride Parade. We have already registered. We will be marching this year. We will have a trolley for those of you that have any mobility issues. We invite you to come on out and join us. Throughout this next coming year, Bates is also going to be engaging in more programming to celebrate our 20th anniversary. And I invite all of you to go ahead and visit us on Bates.org, or you can find us on Facebook, where we're going to update all of our events throughout the year. I'd like to share with you all just a moment now a video clip that happened over the powwow. And perhaps you can just, I use Macs, so this is a PC, so I feel like, what do I do? Okay. It's not on my
Who I am first is Iné, which is Apache. That's who I am. But if people do say, you know, are you Two-Spirit? Are you gay? And I tell them, yeah. This morning, when I was walking down here, I said a little prayer to myself. Before I traveled here, I said a prayer. My aunt prayed for me. In our family, especially as Apache people, before we do anything, we're taught to pray.
Exists to recover and restore the role of Two-Spirit people, and we do this by creating a forum for the expression of the spiritual, artistic, and cultural ways in which Two-Spirit people have always been a part of community.
We accomplished what we wanted. We wanted a powwow that accepted everybody and was welcoming to all people. Going back to the 80s when I went to Red Earth, I didn't necessarily feel that accepted at Red Earth. As a matter of fact, I felt a little shunned or excluded, and so it felt really empowering to me the very first time that we as the organizers really stress very, very much that it has to be welcoming, that everybody in our community is welcome.
Two-Spirit term was kind of brought together really just in the 90s because a lot of us as tribes had our own terms. In Anishinaabe, I think the concept of Two-Spirit actually came from our tradition, from Nijmanidu, like the concept that you could have two beings within a person and that there'd be a special role for that person. We think we're often healers, we're the ones that adopt kids. You know, there's a lot of benefits to being a Two-Spirit and a lot of responsibility as a member of the community. For us, a powwow is a special gathering where we come together, we see old friends,
and we want it to be about community. It's not just about LGBT people, but it's something that we as Two-Spirit people can give back to our community.
The male part of me. And that was the female part of me. That was how it was for me when I learned who I was. Wearing this female outfit with the male part of me inside together. So that's how I chose to present today. For the first time at a powwow, finally presented myself as Two-Spirit. I never thought that I could, and I was so scared. I'm happy to be here.
Way in which I've always felt very othered in my life, of course being mixed race, but also then Two-Spirit and being gay, there's a way I've always felt so othered in the world, but to come here, I'm no longer othered, I'm the norm. That's a beautiful feeling.
I think that if anything, if we could change the lives of those young Two-Spirits who are afraid now and who are so scared of being shunned or unloved by their own parents, then I think it's important to have spaces like this so that people can see that we are part of the Native community and we are just like everybody else.
This evening. If anybody's interested, please visit Bates.org if you would like to donate to our organization or would like to donate to our powwow for next year. Finally, I'd like to close with a little bit of what I shared this year at the powwow. that is indigenous people, we must continue to advocate for indigenous arts, indigenous education, and indigenous cultural inclusion. We must continue to rise up against colonial mentality that continues to decimate indigenous communities around the world. We must continue to resist the decimation of sacred sites and water and land resources. We must continue to support our elders and the seven generations that will follow. Thank you all so much for your time this evening. Thank you, Will, for inviting us here tonight. Thank you, Randy, for all that you have done. Thank you, the Bates Board that is here. And thank you again to the Bates Drum for opening us this evening. My name is Roger Kuhn. Thank you so much, everybody, for your time. If anybody has any questions, I'm willing to take a few questions now. Yes?
How many tribes are represented in your organization, and do you do any outreach to the tribes that are less accepted?
We don't have actually a measurement of tribal nations that are represented in our Bates community. We don't ask about tribal enrollment in our organization. We invite and welcome all people into our organization. As you can see from the slide here, the Bates Board is made up of a variety of tribal nations that represent many regions of what is now called the United States, including the Southeast, the Southwest, North, and at one point we also had a member who had just moved to Canada, and currently we are recruiting some new board members, so hopefully that will shift as well. But we're not currently doing any outreach to other or tribal nations across the United States. All of our work currently is really focused in the Bay Area.
One of the not necessarily totally unique things about the powwow, but something that's pretty special that I feel personally gratified about, is that we have, I think from the beginning, had Mexica Danzantes.
That's right.
Dance at every powwow. And I would say that is building a bridge that is typically neglected between people north and south sides of the U.S. border, realizing that we're all indigenous people of Turtle Island, and that we can find commonalities and share cultures in our intertribal spaces, at least. So really appreciate that. And I wanted to almost like stop you and ask you to mention that in the presentation, so I'm glad you asked that. Thank you.
Anyone else? Any final questions for the evening? Well, then otherwise, I hope you all have a good rest of your evening. Thank you so much for your time, and have a lovely night.